Celebration Church in the chapel right here. We're going to have a great day together. Hey, it is so good to see everybody. And if you are here for the first time, let me just give you an extra special welcome home.
Yeah.
It is an honor to have anyone come and spend part of the weekend with us. We have a Connect card and a seat pocket in front of you. Please find that card, fill out your information. Listen to us after church, right back in that corner of our connection point. We have a gift for you. We'd love to answer any questions and encourage you, so please do that. We love to worship God together in this place, so enter in, lift your hearts, your hands, your voices, sing your praises to Jesus. Pastor Randy has an awesome on-time word of God for us today. Open your hearts, receive it, and grow. Would you stand as we get ready to sing, and would you turn around about you and greet a few people?
I know you don't care.
tell them these words. God, we love you. We praise you today, God. You are good. Thank you. We praise you today, dear Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We love you. We love you. Father, thank you that we can come and worship you here today. Lord, speak your word to our hearts today. God bless Pastor Randy as he comes. Amen, church.
We gave away this past week over 450 bags of food. Through the elementary schools, we brought the bags to the elementary school. They gave them to the families that was expressed to us. Some teachers thought, you know, a lot of these kids would not be eating this holiday break if it wasn't for those bags of food. So. What a great way to touch kids' lives, families' lives with the love of Jesus. So thank you for doing that. Yay. Give yourselves a hand. That's why our church is here, to touch people for Jesus. Right now, I'd like to take out your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 1. And while you're turning there, we'll be looking at verses 22 to 23. And one time, a teacher asked her first grade class, why do we have Thanksgiving? And one little boy raised his hand and he said, so we know when to start shopping for Christmas. Well, you know, with Thanksgiving Thursday, we are now officially in the Christmas season.
Yes.
And so we're going to be looking at, in the next couple weeks, we're going to be looking at Emmanuel, God with us, past, present, and future. And in Matthew chapter 1, verse 22, it says, all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Father, we just thank you that you are with us, God with us. And God, just open up our hearts to what this season is really all about in our lives and for those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said,
Amen.
So I kind of got the inspiration for this series from one of the most beloved Christmas stories of all time, Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. And we know the story how mean, miserly old Scrooge was visited by the ghost of Christmas past, Christmas present, and Christmas future. So I thought we're going to do the same thing. We're going to look at Emmanuel past, Emmanuel present, and Emmanuel future. God with us in the past, in the present, and in the future. So this week we're going to be looking at God with us, Emmanuel past. And most of us were alive in 1969. How many remember though that year? That was the year we had touchdown. Those who lived will remember the day that Eagle One touched down on the moon. And it was just a momentous day in human history when man stepped foot on the moon. And of course we know the famous words, one small step for man, one giant step for mankind. And the world in 1969 was actually a pretty crazy time in those days. The world was kind of topsy-turvy. Now, some of you might remember that's the year that the Mets won the 1969 World Series, the Miracle Mets, and they were like the worst team in baseball, and they were so bad that their manager, Casey Stengel, said, come and see my amazing Mets. I've been in this game for like 100 years, but I see new ways to lose that I never knew existed before. So when your own manager says that's bad, but here they won the World Series. And America at that time was in the midst of change and turmoil. At that time, the hippie movement was going full bloom, and flower power, which called for free sex and free love, and the drug culture was just exploding, and the model then was tune in, drop out, and turn on. It was a time of mass anti-war demonstrations and protests. Burning of the flag was popular back then. Cities were rocked by race riots. Our cities were actually burning down and very violent. And I remember growing up in New Jersey, I remember seeing the National Guard trucks driving by our house, going down to Newark to deal with the riots down in the city of Newark. And American boys were coming home in body bags from the Vietnam War to the tune of like 100 to 150 a week. And the war had gone for years with no end in sight. The Middle East was ready to boil over. It was a flashpoint for World War III between America and the failed Soviet Union. And we were afraid they could lead to a nuclear holocaust. And yet in the midst of all that uncertainty and turmoil and anti-government and anti-American feeling, Apollo 11 landed on the moon. And the American flag was planted on another planet. And at that moment, all Americans were once again proud and united. For that moment, the world cheered, and we could find hope and strength in that special touchdown. I mean, even to this day, people will say, if we could put a man on the moon. Yeah, if we could put a man on the moon, why can't we cure the common cold? If we could put a man on the moon, why can't we make coffee machines that work? If we can put a man on the moon, how come we can't make a diaper that changes itself? If we can put a man on the moon, why can't we make a prescription bottle that's easy to open, right? Yeah, it was an amazing event. It was an amazing achievement. But as great as the touchdown of Eagle One was, an even greater touchdown took place 2,000 years earlier. And it came one night, right in the midst of dark and troubled times, times of great political and moral and spiritual unrest. And like the touchdown of Eagle One, it would bring hope and joy and peace to the world. And we continue to celebrate it to this day. Unlike the touchdown of Eagle One, which was watched by the whole world at the 6 o'clock news, that's what we had, three stations, so you kind of had to watch it back then, right? This one was hardly noticed at the time. And it took place in a stable, in a town that no one ever heard of, a little town called Bethlehem. And yet our world would never be the same. And the touchdown I'm referring to is the day that God came down to earth. The day God, Emmanuel, God with us, came to be with us. It was a day foretold 7 centuries earlier by the prophet Isaiah when he said, those living in darkness have seen a great light. That's why we celebrate Christmas with lights. And Isaiah 7:14 says, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and you'll call him Emmanuel. And in Isaiah 9:6 it says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and it will be called Counselor, it will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. 2,000 years ago, a child was born in Bethlehem, in a manger. And because of that, our world and our lives would never be the same. So this morning we're going to look at Emmanuel past, God with us in the past, and see what that means to our lives today. First of all, let's start by looking at the birth of Jesus. The birth of Jesus Christ was without parallel in history. There have been a lot of babies born down through the years, right? And they're all special. They're all beautiful. I know your baby was always a burger baby. It was just so beautiful. I remember when my son Ryan was born, and he was our firstborn, and you know, sometimes when they're the firstborn, they come out and their head's like a cone. And I didn't know that. And so I'm thinking, oh my gosh, my son's gonna be a cone head. And the doctor said, oh no, it'll go down, and that was okay. That was a new thing. But the birth of Jesus was unique. It was unlike any other birth. How was it? How was it one of a kind? Well, first of all, Jesus was born of a virgin. When the angel spoke to Mary, and said, "Hey, you're going to give birth to a son," Mary's response was, "Are you sure you got the right address? Because I'm a virgin. I've never been with a man. How can this be?" And the baby Jesus was the only baby ever born to a virgin. Larry King was once asked, "If you could interview anyone in history, who would you interview?" And he said, "Jesus Christ." And he said, "I would like to ask him, were you born of a virgin?" Because Larry King knew that even though he wasn't a believer, he hit the nail right on the head. And everything about Jesus Christ, his claims, his death, his resurrection, all begin with the virgin birth. If Jesus was born of a virgin, then no one could dispute that he was truly the Messiah of God.
Right.
Also, we see that Jesus was born without a sinful nature or the taint of sin. The Bible says, "He who knew no sin became sin for us." Jesus never sinned. He never yielded to temptation, and that made him the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. The only time sin ever touched him was when he hung on the cross. And the Bible says, "He who knew no sin became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God." And then we see the incarnation of Jesus Christ. The Word became flesh. And we see that in John chapter 1, verse 1 to 5. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it." And then it goes on in verse 14, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and the only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." So we see that Jesus was the Word made flesh. Jesus was 100% man. He was as human as you and I are. And he was also 100% God, the one true God, the second person of the Trinity, the triune God. And he was the Son of God. God and man in the same body. Now, sometimes it's a little hard for us to wrap our minds around, but it makes sense in the sense that only as a man could Jesus die for the sins of man. But only as God could he take on the sins of the world. So his birth was unique of all history. And then we see the life of Jesus. The birth of Jesus, as beautiful and as captivating as that was, that was just the beginning. God came and lived among us with a purpose, with a mission. And we must never lose sight of that Christmas is more than just a nice story or the celebration of a birth. Or, you know, everybody loves babies, don't they? Everybody loves Christmas. Who doesn't like Christmas? Yeah. There's nothing threatening or intimidating or offensive about the birth of a baby. Yeah, everybody loves jolly old St. Nicholas, right? Everybody loves Santa Claus. And everybody loves a baby. Everybody loves the baby Jesus. Sweet baby Jesus. Everybody loves him. Because babies don't tell people how to live.
Right.
They don't tell you to stop sinning. They don't make claims and commands. Jesus, the man, on the other hand, lots of people have problems with him. And the man, Jesus, came with a purpose, with a mission, and not everyone was happy about it. But Jesus came with a mission. He came with a mission to show us the Father. Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." And one time, Philip even said to him, "Hey, Jesus, show us the Father." And Jesus said, "Philip, don't you know me after all this time? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you want to know what God is like, what he thinks, what he says, what he wants, what he desires, what he likes, what he dislikes, what his will is, look at Jesus." Jesus reveals the Father to us. He shows us God in a way that we can understand. It's kind of like God saying, I'm going to put this so simple that even you can understand. You know, you ever have a teacher or instructor that said, here, I'm going to show you this so simple that even a lunkhead like you can understand. Well, Jesus presented God to us in a way that we could understand. I like a story Chuck Swindoll used to tell, and he used to tell a story about an old farmer who was sitting in his living room one winter morning, and he looked out of his window and he saw a group of sparrows, and the mercury was dropping below zero, and he looked at those sparrows and he kind of could understand that they were probably going to freeze to death. So he got the idea of, he put on his coat and he went out and he opened up the barn door, and he wanted the sparrows to fly into the barn and survive. But the problem was the sparrows were too afraid of him. They were too afraid of his big manly self. They couldn't get past the idea of this human being. And he just thought, I wish I could just become a sparrow and communicate to him that this is okay, that this is the way to be saved. And that's basically what Jesus did for us. He came to show us the Father in a way that we can understand. But also, he was also the perfect example. Not only did Jesus come to show and reveal the Father to us, but he also came to show us how we should live. Jesus was the perfect example of a Christian life. He's our model. He's our prototype. He's our blueprint. He's the pattern. He's our perfect example of love. John 13:34, a new commandment I give, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. If you want to know how to love people, just look at how Jesus loved people. He is a perfect example of works and service. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. He's our perfect example of a Christian lifestyle. 1 John 2:6, whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus walked. So we are to fashion and mold our life on the example of our Lord. Now, isn't it nice when somebody shows you something? You can learn by somebody getting up and lecturing to you. And that's, some people can do that. But it's even better if somebody shows you how to do it, right? That's why we love YouTube, because you get on YouTube and they'll show you how to fix your sink or whatever. They'll actually show you. And here, you know, it's like, here, watch this. Watch the way I do it, and that's how it's done. I remember when I was just a little kid, my dad made me go out and sweep the driveway. And I was out sweeping the driveway, and my dad comes out, hey, that's not how you do it. And he runs up and grabs a broom out of my hair. Here's how you sweep the driveway, like this. And I'm just looking at him like, could you show me that again, Dad? Yeah, that's how you do it. And finally, by the time he swept half the driveway, he caught on what I was doing. It does help a lot when somebody shows you, when somebody demonstrates how to do it. Jesus showed us how to live. But he also came to warn us. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, from that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Jesus came to personally warn us, to tell us that the kingdom of heaven is near. Salvation is at hand. There is a final judgment, and it carries eternal consequences. You know, Jesus preached on hell more than he preached on heaven. And much of Jesus' preaching and teaching and parables had to do with us standing before God and giving an account of our lives, and how to escape the coming wrath and finding salvation. And just like Jesus warned us, we're supposed to warn others. And then also Jesus came to sympathize with our weaknesses. I mean, how cool is it that our God came to earth to live among us as one of us? What other God can relate to us on the level of our God? He knows what it's like to be us. You know, the Bible says we have a high priest who can sympathize with our weaknesses. God knows personally what it's like to be a baby, to have a dirty diaper, to be burped, He knows what it's like to be a child and fall and scrape your knee and have to eat your vegetables. He knows what it's like to put in a hard day's work at the carpenter shop. He knows what it's like to say goodbye to someone you love. We believe his dad, stepdad, Joseph, died before he started his ministry. He knows what it's like to cry at the graveside of a friend when Jesus wept at Lazarus' grave. He knows what it's like to be tired and hungry and thirsty. He knows what it's like to deal with troublesome people. He even knows what it's like to deal with difficult family members. How many can relate to that, right? Don't look at around. And he can relate to our suffering. God knows what it's like to be blind because they blindfolded Jesus. God knows what it's like to be paralyzed and not be able to move your arms and your legs because his arms and his legs were nailed to a cross. He couldn't move. He knows what it's like to have your body waste away as his body was wasted away as he was scourged. He knows what it's like to die. No one can say to God, you don't know how I feel. You don't know what it's like to be a human being. You haven't walked in our shoes, God. Who are you to judge me? God says, yeah, I have walked in your shoes. You know what I'm saying? You don't really know someone until you walked a mile in their shoes. And then one comedian said, the good news about that is you're a mile ahead of them, so you can steal their shoes. But God knows what it's like to walk in our shoes. One night when I was pastoring in Kansas, I was going through chemotherapy. And I just happened, for some reason, I was at the church 9:30 at night. It was like a Tuesday night or something. I don't remember why I was there. I was usually never there, especially when I was going through chemotherapy. 9:30 at night. But for some reason, I was there. You think it's a God thing, right? I was there, and the phone rang. And I'm like, who's calling the church at 9:30 at night? You know, do they think we staff this place 24 hours a day? And so I said, man, I said, well, I'm going to answer the phone. I answered the phone, and it was a lady. And she didn't even go to our church. But she was a believer, and she was dealing with her second bout of cancer, and she was very down and very depressed, and I could totally understand. And so, you know, she was just telling about, and I was trying to, you know, encourage her, speak life to her. And so finally she just said, oh, you don't know what it's like to go through what I'm going through. And I said, oh, really? Well, it just so happens that I'm in my 6th month of chemotherapy. And it got real quiet. It's really well. You have such a good attitude, you know. But the whole conversations changed because when she realized that I could relate to her of what exactly she's going through. And we have a God who can relate with us and know exactly what we're going. He can sympathize with us in a very personal way. What a wondrous, special God that is. And he came to bring us joy. You know the song, joy to the world, the Lord has come. Mm-hmm. Wherever Jesus went, there was great joy and expectation. When he showed up, people were, you know, the lame walked, the blind could see, and the deaf could hear. Demons were sent packing. Sins were forgiven, burdens lifted, lives changed. There was no joy like the joy when Jesus comes into your heart. And having your sins washed away, being a new creation in Christ, it's an eternal, everlasting joy. It is a joy unspeakable and full of more. That's a joy that goes way past a holiday but fills your life every day that you live. So what does Emmanuel Pass mean? Okay, Jesus came. What does that mean? 2,000 years ago, God touched down on earth. I remember when I was in Bethlehem, and we went to the Church of the Nativity, and you go down these stairs, down to what they call the grotto. And at the bottom of the grotto, there's a hole in the floor. And supposedly, what they believe, I don't know if it's, you know, who knows, but what they believe is that this was this floor, you can see some, like, stones down there, that this was the stable that Jesus was born in. And our guide said to us, this is where heaven and earth. And this is where heaven and earth meets, the greatest touchdown. The birth of Jesus Christ is more than just a birthday celebration. It's more than just a nice holiday. It's more than just an excuse to shop and give presents. The arrival of that babe was the most significant event in human history. And it's the most significant event in your life. And it carries some drastic ramifications for you and for every single human being that's ever lived. First of all, it means you've got to decide who Jesus is. Jesus asked Peter, who do others say I am? You know, a lot of people, you hear many opinions of who Jesus is. Everyone from secularists to atheists to Buddhists to Muslims all have an opinion of who Jesus is. You probably first heard about Jesus from other people. Maybe when you were a little child, your mom and dad told you about Jesus. You grew up in a Christian home, that's great. Maybe you heard about Jesus when you went to church for the first time, or from friends. Or maybe you're sitting here in this church right now and thinking, hey, this is the first I've ever heard of these. We always hear about Jesus from others. However, the Lord confronts each and every one of us, and he said to Peter, and he says to us, who do you say I am? And you know, there's only three possibilities. This is kind of a multiple choice answer. Either Jesus was a liar, a lunatic, or a ruler. Now, if Jesus was a liar, that means he wasn't the Savior and he's not the Son of God. And if Jesus was a liar, this was all just a big hoax to get himself crucified, right? Now, in my opinion, if Jesus of Nazareth was a liar, in my opinion, if he purposely deceived us, if he was just some kind of a deceiver or trickster, then I think he was worse than Adolf Hitler. And as terrible as Adolf Hitler was, at least he was sincere about who he was. He even wrote a book called Mein Kampf telling us who he was, but nobody paid attention. Jesus, if he was a liar, has deceived so many people into putting their faith in him, even to the point of going to their deaths, believing in him, believing his words were true. And if Jesus was a liar, that makes him such a terrible person, it's beyond belief. If Jesus knowingly deceived us, that had to be like the worst crime against humanity ever committed. So I don't believe Jesus was a liar. Well, maybe Jesus was a lunatic. I mean, maybe he really thought he was the Son of God, but he was just nutso. He was a crazy man. You know, like, I am Napoleon. I am Caesar. I am Randy Viscount. Okay, I am Randy. Now, the question is, if Jesus was just a crazy guy, could he teach like Jesus taught? His teachings are so profound, so inspired, such wisdom, such depth of truth. It's hard to believe that a lunatic, that a kook, could teach that way. I don't believe that. So that only means that Jesus was Lord. He really was who he said he was. He really was born of a virgin. He really healed the sick. He really cast out demons. He really died for our sins. And he really rose from the dead. Every human being, you've got to decide who Jesus is. Was he a liar? Was he a lunatic? Or was he the Lord our God? Now, if he is Lord, what does that mean? That means his words are true. Either you obey them or you reject them. Jesus said, I am the truth and the life. No man, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. Now, a lot of people have a problem with that. Wow, that's just, how can that be? That's just his opinion. Well, one time Babe Ruth was up at bat, and the umpire called, strike three, you're out. And Babe Ruth turned to the umpire and said, there's 40,000 people in this stadium who know that last pitch was a ball, you tomato head. And the umpire just smiled back and he said, well, that may be, but mine's the only opinion that counts. You may not like Jesus' teachings, you may not like his claims or his commands. They may go against your philosophies, your beliefs, they may not be politically correct. You may say, and I've had people say this to me, well, I just don't agree with that. Well, but you know what, in the end, there's only one opinion that counts, and and that's God's opinion.
Yep.
His opinion is the only one that counts. His words are true. So what will you do? Pontius Pilate asked that question. He said, what shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Christ? See, that's the answer every one of us has to answer. What am I going to do with Jesus, who is called the Christ? Colonel James Irwin, who was the eighth man to walk on the moon, said, quote, it is more significant that God walked on earth than that a man walked on the moon. So what shall I do? Should I trust him and put my faith in him? Or reject him and turn my back on him? Go do my own thing. You know, those who put their faith in him, the Bible says, will never be put to shame, but will receive everlasting life. So I don't know what you're going to do, but I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to put my faith in him because he is Emmanuel, God with us. Let's bow our heads as we go to the Lord this morning. Father, we just thank you for your goodness. And if you're here this morning, I just want to ask you, who do you say Jesus is? That's a question you have to answer for yourself. Do you believe he is the Son of God, or do you think he's something else? And maybe somebody said, I don't believe it. Well, that's your choice. But Jesus also said, the other question was, what am I going to do with Jesus who is called Christ? That's another question you have to answer. Now, if Jesus really is who he says he is, then you have to decide, am I going to receive him, or am I going to reject him? Am I going to receive his love or reject his love? Am I going to receive his salvation or reject his salvation? That's a choice only you can make. No one can make that for you. And if you're here this morning and if you don't want to make the choice, I want to make Jesus my Lord and my Savior. If that's your desire to you this morning, if you've never done that, or if you've gotten away from it but want to come back to that, if that's you, just as a way of saying, hey, Pastor, would you pray for me? I'm right there, and I'm ready to do that. Just put your hand. We'll pray for you. Anyone in this room, just want to make sure you're ready. All right, and I just want to ask you as believers, Jesus is our example. And we have to decide, am I going to live like him or not? So that's the decision we have to make every day. Am I going to be like Jesus or not? As we do our everyday lives. And I just pray that God will help us to be more and more like him as we go through our daily lives. Father, I just thank you, Lord, that you would just help us walk as you walk and do as you do. And we just thank you for the example you were to us. And God, help us to live out God with us, Emmanuel, God with us, every day in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stuck with me is, why haven't we invented self-changing diapers? I mean, I love that. What a wonderful day it has been here today. Ushers, would you come forward? It's time to give, amen? Isn't it good? You know, Generation Church, you are a giving church. And why do you give? Because you love. You know, when you give, you're showing love to the Lord. When you give, you're showing love to our community. I think Pastor mentioned it at the beginning of his sermon that we gave over 400 bags of food to people in need. Why did we do that? We did it because you love and you give. Not because you have to, but because we get to. Amen?
Amen.
It's so good.
Yes.
So we're going to thank God for this opportunity once again to give this morning. Father, we love you. We give you praise in this house. We honor this house. God, we love you. Thank you for the opportunity that we get to give to you today. Further your kingdom, continue to do what you do. And we love you. In Jesus' name, we pray. Everyone said?
Amen.
Amen. God bless you again as you give today. Next Sunday is Let It Snow Day. Are you excited? Some of you are like, I left the North Country to get away from the snow. Well, we're going to make it here in Mesa, believe it or not, next week. It's going to be a wonderful time to invite your family that isn't coming, your friends that aren't coming, Maybe your neighbors, coworkers, people you've retired with. If you know someone who isn't comfortable, invite them.
Yeah.
We have invite cards in the lobby. You can pick those up on your way out. We're going to have snow. We're going to have Santa here. It's going to be a great time for the whole family. Oh, you don't want to miss them.
No.
We're the Generation Ladies in the house. Where are you at? Let me hear you. Let me hear you. All right. I know you can be loud on that. I'm sure you are at home. Coming up. See, you got you. There you go. Coming up is our Christmas party for you ladies. So December 9th and 10th at 6:30. Both times we're going to have one party here in Mesa, one in Ahwatukee. Ladies, if you haven't signed up, you can still do that. It's not sold out yet, but it could be soon. So sign up. You don't want to miss that. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful time. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Do you believe it? Come on, ladies. I know you.
Yes.
Just,
yes.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Would you stand with me? Generation Church, we love you. So grateful that you're here today. If it was your first time here today, welcome home. There was a Connect card in the seat back pocket in front of you there. If you took a moment to fill that out, thank you. We have a free gift for you back in the back corner here, our connection point. Please come on back there. If you haven't filled it out, you can do it. It'll only take you about a minute to do it. We love you. We're glad you're here. Church, be blessed. You are dismissed. Have a great day.